The mountains have had a lot of people in them. There's been a lot of people. Any landscape you see, you know, there's such a lot of history and depth. And when you get up into the mountains, right up high, there's areas which no longer exist. So the moraine walls are, as the glaciers recede, the moraine walls are falling in. So a lot of the areas where the huts were have gone completely. They don't exist anymore. And that process is happening more and more. And I think the main change for me, and maybe it's a little bit about going up there and not wanting to go up and climb mountains, it's wanting to go up there and just experience the place. But I saw it with different eyes. It felt vulnerable. It felt very, very vulnerable, where in the past I'd felt very vulnerable. I'd felt like this is a really scary place and I have to be careful. Whereas this time I thought that, you know, you can see climate change in action up there, boy, more than anywhere else. And so you have the sense of the fragility of the place, you know, this sense of the mountains being pushed up. They're growing, but at the same time they're falling down. You know, the sense of change and movement all the time. Well, I always think that on plein air experience is a little bit about working a place out. You know, looking at it, studying it, thinking about how it was formed, trying to work it out. Trying to get a sense of the energy of a place. I mean, I always like painting places that are kind of moving, and then I guess trying to give the viewer that sense. It's a bloody weird thing, painting,
okay.
And creativity of any kind. But to me, the real joy of it is not being in total control. You know, you're always looking for happy accidents. There's a sense of seeing, you know, you can see it and you see how the ice has fallen down and how it's coming down and how it's carved out the rock and then the shingle, and it's sort of quite clear, it's quite overt. Trying to get the energy into it, trying to give it a sense of life, you know, that it is like this moving thing. That you know, it could come all tumbling down at any minute. When I started going back to New Zealand, of course, I started looking in terms of the landscape and looking in terms of memory. Memory became incredibly important, and painting the areas around where I grew up. But always, it's always laden with some kind of emotional significance. And for me, the kind of figure represents a sort of an intrusion on looking, and I guess that represents the way we look at landscape through the prism of our memories. You know, so we're looking at a place and you're looking at it in terms of how you emotionally remember it, and that kind of thing is what I want to bring into the studio, I think. And it seems to make sense in the studio. It's sort of how I paint, you know, as I'm painting a landscape or putting the figure in the landscape, it's sort of me there experiencing that place. And if it intuitively starts feeling like I'm remembering it like that, then that starts to, then the painting starts to work. That sense of the vertigo and that sense of looking down into the void, I just, you know, that is phenomenal. you know, for me, frightening, absolutely frightening. That the first days when I was in the mountains where I remember being there as a little kid and freaking out completely. And I can understand why now, because, you know, just this, being in an environment like that and just the noises and the ice and, you know, like an environment like that is overwhelming. You know, you, these vast drop-offs and these big, you know, big kind of walls of ice that are ready to sort of fall down at any time. And, yeah, kind of incredible. I do always feel like my life has been coloured by, a kind of an insecurity, a basic sense of something not being right. Painting has definitely helped with that in terms of giving me a way of trying to describe that to people, to try and show people what's going on, to kind of say, you know, that sense of unease, that sense of something's wrong here, something's not quite right, or how do I find a feeling of safety, kind of a safe place to work from. That sense of being as free as possible to do whatever you want is what I've always loved about painting and drawing. And even though the mountain paintings are, they're based on the Southern Alps, it is more about an analogy with some kind of an emotional state. But when I get into the studio, that landscape doesn't become specific. The absolute best times with painting are when something happens and you had no intention of it happening and it pops there and you think, ooh, shit, where did that come from, you know? And you're wanting that to happen all the time, and it doesn't. You know, sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But you certainly want whatever you get, you certainly want it to sort of resonate in some way and feel kind of right. Often with paintings, you know, people always talk about how quick they are, how quickly they come. And some do, but a lot don't. And a lot of paintings will take me a hell of a long time and I'll end up changing them and you know, work them up over months. And I think with this exhibition, I didn't want to do that. What I wanted is to have the freedom to do whatever I wanted to do and do it on a really large scale and more have the freedom of the works on paper, because that is what I feel when I'm out there. There's a sort of a kind of a physical quality to it, which I really love. And on a large scale, of course, it's harder to do, but I still work quite quickly and if I slow down, I do feel like I lose the energy. I often look at people's work, and if you see film of them working, you think, oh, that's kind of fascinating. You get more of a sense of their work. And I saw film of myself working, and I realised I stab at the painting. I stab it. I actually, you know, dig it in. It's like quite a physical, violent kind of act I do. And you know, it's aggressive. And I was quite surprised, I was quite shocked. I didn't realise I worked like that. But I think that's what I love about it, the physicality of it. He's not answering, see? Yeah, now you answer. Where are you? Where are you?
I'm here.
What have you got for me? What have you got?
Totally starkers.
Oh, yeah, I'm not. I can see you got a T-shirt on. The project with Geoff, which is now, I think we're at 408 paintings, didn't start off with any intention of anything. It was, Geoff had lost his partner, and it was around COVID time, as I was ringing him every night just to make sure how he was getting on, and he was totally grief-struck. He was in a terrible way, poor guy. And these kind of talks, and then which morphed into paintings, became kind of like little interludes for him. You know, we were talking on FaceTime. Normally we'd just talk on the phone, but I think that presence, you know, just I was there probably, was probably a comfort for him. It really did feel like during COVID time that became so important to remain connected, and for me to be able to paint during that time meant it gave me a sort of framework. I wasn't sitting there having to listen. It wasn't like a therapy session. I was painting, and that felt more natural to me. He was a model for a long, long time. I've done drawings of him constantly. And so it was pretty effortless to actually slip into while I was talking to him. So even though Geoff was in need of that connection, I think I was too. And they say that about portraiture all the time, that you know, you as the painter are reflected in the sitter. You know, you're there in it as well. You know, you paint them through your eyes, and I think that's a great thing, really a great aspect of it, how you see that person.
Now, where are you looking?
Yeah. It was probably when I was well into 200, you know, I was right up there, and I thought, well, actually, they could be quite an interesting show. Because rather than having a portrait of someone, you've got 200 different versions, and it's more how I paint. You're not saying everything in the same painting, and there's change. You know, you're seeing change. We could look at the paintings and actually notice a psychological change as Geoff sort of came out of it. For some reason, every time I do it, it's a different experience. It's kind of the way it's morphed now is to, you know, he always has he's got his cigarettes and he's got his drink, and sometimes I put that in and sometimes I don't. But he moves like you wouldn't believe. He's constantly moving, and I kind of love that slight agitation almost. And I think I've always loved that about it, that you're trying to capture a sense of him moving. I always loved this idea of you're looking at the screen and you're in there too. There's a little you as well. And I always thought that was important. I think the first one I didn't put it in, but ever since then I've put in the little me. But yes, it's just a sort of a reference to that connection, you know, that lovely idea that there's you in the screen, you're in the painting as well, which is kind of lovely.
Ah, that'll do. Okay, Geoff. See you soon. Thanks for that.
See you on Friday.
Yep. Bye-bye.